Daniel, thank you so much for joining me and welcome back to New Mexico in Focus.
Of course, always a pleasure.
So what was your initial reaction to hearing this conversation among APD officers that the audience just heard? And deeper than that, what kinds of things did it bring up for you as you had a chance to think about it a bit more?
You know, I think my first reaction, Jeff, was that it was shocking but not surprising. I think hearing the kinds of things that these officers are saying put so baldly, we're not used to hearing that. But I think for folks who have been paying close attention to the way police reform has happened in Albuquerque, who care deeply about public safety, community safety, it's not surprising that these attitudes are pervasive in APD and really pervasive in law enforcement. And I think as I sort of sat with this over the last couple of weeks, it has really reminded me of the role that police play in our sort of public safety, quote unquote, universe, and the reliance that we put on them to do what we heard the officer say in the footage, he didn't become a cop to do. He said, I didn't become a cop to help old ladies cross the street. And yet we do rely on police officers in so many cases to be more than police officers. And that's pretty deeply problematic.
Yeah, I want to ask too, and I think the answer is probably yes, but if you don't mind unpacking it a little bit, did the conversation that you heard feel familiar to you in the context of your work on police violence and police misconduct?
Yeah, it did. You know, I think we know that there are systemic cultural issues at APD. And maybe we'll talk a little more today about the consent decree and that process. But I went back and read the DOJ findings letter that was issued at this point over 10 years ago.
April of 2014.
That was the culmination of this big investigation and that led to what is now the consent decree. And it felt like when they talked about the culture at APD in very strong language, it felt like they could have been describing this conversation, talking about a culture of aggression, talking about a culture that valorizes violence, right? We heard him say, I like violent encounters with violent people, talking about dismissing community concerns. All of these are the things that DOJ called out about APD over a decade ago, and all of these are the things that we heard put really baldly by an officer who didn't think anybody would hear what he said.
Yeah, it's such a quiet part out loud sort of moment. I want to talk about that phrase, police culture, a little bit, and in the context of the consent decree, yeah, which you mentioned. The reason that the 1994 crime bill includes a provision that allows the federal government to do these big sweeping civil investigations of police departments and then hold them accountable in court to make changes was to impact what the Justice Department refers to as police culture, yeah, right? What they had before was like Serpico era NYPD, where they could come in and indict a few cops, but it really didn't do anything to change this broader culture,
right?
And so it is that culture, that phrase police culture was on everybody's lips in this town in the run-up to the findings letter you just mentioned. What does police culture mean internally to a department like APD or any other, and also to the communities of people who are policed? What's the phrase mean?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I think you're right. Culture is at the heart of any kind of police reform work. And I think kind of no matter what sort of work we do, we're aware that there's the things that our employee handbook says that we do and the way things work in our office. And then there's the way things actually work in our office. When we talk about police culture, it's the way things actually work in the police department. It's the implicit, and as we heard in this video, sometimes explicit values that are communicated from officer to officer. It's the attitude and approach to policing that officers take. And it's the way that officers position themselves relative to each other and relative to the community.
That is maybe the best explanation I've ever heard for what police culture is or is supposed to be. So when the findings letter came out and it became clear that there was going to be this big reform project, what do you think the community deserved or even expected in terms of the way the culture would change?
Yeah, I think there's there has been a hope that the consent decree was going to be the sort of magic wand that was going to fix policing in Albuquerque, and I think there was some expectation of that in some places, and I think we pretty immediately saw that that wasn't what it was going to be. But I think what the community deserved was a set of commitments by the city to really transform from top to bottom the way that APD does policing, and for a real commitment that those changes would not just be changes on paper, would not be superficial, and would actually result in better outcomes for people who are exposed to the police in our community. And I think 10 years on, we've seen that that is a mixed bag in terms of whether or not we actually got what we deserved.
I think it's important to mention too in this context that in addition to the culture of aggression that you mentioned from the findings letter, the Justice Department also found a culture of leadership that not only looked the other way,
yes,
but frankly encouraged this sort of behavior. Do you think the community expected more accountability, internal accountability as well?
Absolutely. I think a huge part of the, I think that's a huge key point about culture at APD and a part about the consent decree is that they found not only that this culture existed, but that it was propagated by the choices that leadership was making, that there was not sufficient accountability, that there was not sufficient, that that culture was inculcated in training and then was just carried on through the way that leadership approached that. And so I think certainly the public had a right to expect and deserve that as a result of the consent decree reforms, we would see a change in APD's willingness to hold itself and its officers accountable.
Gotcha. I want to shift gears just a little bit here and ask for your response to a comment about this recording from Sean Willoughby, who is the president of the Albuquerque Police Officers Association. I'm quoting now, "These guys were joking around. They were decompressing. They were saying inappropriate stuff, like a lot of us do with our friends and family when we're not in public," end quote. Daniel, do you talk like this with your friends and family when you're not in public?
I don't, and I don't know anyone, even folks who I know who have really stressful jobs, who decompress from their jobs as emergency medical providers or as hospice caregivers or whatever, who decompress by expressing, not just using racial slurs, but expressing racial sentiments, racist
straight
sentiments.
Up racism.
Straight up racism. It's not just that the horrific word was used, but that it was used in the context of very racist sentiments about interracial dating. I don't know folks who decompress by valorizing violence. That's not acceptable. The first thing it made me think of when I read that comment from Sean Willoughby was frankly of Mark Furman, who got famous during the O.J. Simpson case, who sued LAPD for saying that the stress of his job had made him racist.
Uh-huh.
And so this is a canard that we've seen racist cops use for decades now, that their jobs are so stressful they have to be racist. And it wasn't convincing in the case of Mark Furman, and I don't think it's convincing here.
I want to ask another question about the police union. Because of the consent decree process, they may very well not have the sort of policy making or protecting officers' jobs power that they had in years past. I wonder from your perspective, what sort of influence does that particular police union still have?
I think one place where I've seen the police union be very influential and really vocal is in promoting this narrative that the community safety problems that Albuquerque has that are real are the fault of the consent decree. And I remember a couple of years ago when the police union was putting up billboards that said, "Crime matters more." And of course, this was during the same time as a surge in Black Lives Matter activism. And I think the juxtaposition of those phrases was quite telling. And I think we hear this narrative, I hear it all the time in my work, that the reason people are experiencing crime in Albuquerque is because officers' hands are tied by the expectation that they not engage in a pattern and practice of rights violations. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is a pretty damaging narrative, and it's a pretty untrue narrative, too. Chief Medina has called the consent decree the best thing that happened to APD.
Yeah, and as a good civil rights lawyer friend of mine likes to say, no, guys, it's not that you can't do your jobs anymore. It's just that we would like for you to follow the Constitution when you do them.
Which does not feel like an outrageous expectation of people who are paid public salaries and who are granted extraordinary power to, they carry guns and they have authorization to use them. They need to have accountability when they do so.
Yeah. Let's explore the connection between policing and this broader conversation about public safety that you mentioned. Some of the governor's proposals that of course failed during the special legislative session last month would have created more contact between police officers and residents, not to mention more contact from other elements of the criminal legal system. How should residents, especially those who have heard these recordings now, think about those kinds of proposals that would create more contact?
I think, you know, certainly for all of my life and longer in this country, we have had this attitude where when we perceive something as a problem, one of our first instincts is to try and make it a crime or to try and make it something that can be solved by the criminal legal system. And often what that means is calling in cops as the first people who interact with that problem. And I think what we have seen through our experience and what this video, I think, puts in really sharp relief for us is that that is not always or even usually the correct approach to many of the things that we face as a society. And I think one thing that this sort of drumbeat that we've heard from the governor and in some local government contexts as well is that the criminal legal system can be the place that we can the way that we can get people who need services access to those services. But what we hear from the officer is that he doesn't want to do that.
Totally.
I didn't become a cop to help old ladies cross the street. It's pretty, seems pretty similar to, I didn't become a cop to help an unhoused person get access to services. And so I think what this should make us very wary of is of these proposals that purport to solve issues like homelessness, like behavioral health problems, like poverty, by bringing in the criminal legal system and further entrapping people who experience those problems in this process of police, jails, courts, and prisons.
We've got a minute or two left. I just want to mention that I did ask APD a series of questions as I was preparing this week's show. As of the Wednesday that we're sitting here having this conversation, I didn't get any answers from them. And, you know, I asked all the stuff you would expect a journalist to ask. Do these guys still have their jobs? When did Chief Medina know about this recording? I didn't get any answers. So in the absence of the city of Albuquerque being willing to course correct, and even beyond the possibility of Justice Department intervention, solving some of the issues that led to us hearing a recording like this, what are we missing here? Is there a role for the legislature? Is this beyond government? What are some of the bigger solutions that we need to be thinking about that aren't part of this conversation about community safety?
I think the biggest missing piece, and this is directly tied to what we were just talking about, is to really rethink our perception of what makes us safe in our communities. And to, as we're thinking about community safety, to think about things like housing as an investment in community safety, to think about investments in behavioral health as an investment in community safety, and to reframe our perception of what keeps us safe away from cops and prisons and towards care for our community. And I think when we do that, we can really mitigate a lot of the harms that this brings to mind, and we can actually make some progress toward making our communities safe.
A philosophical shift first and then the policy discussion thereafter.
That's right. I think we can't get these policies done if we're still thinking the way that we've been thinking since the 60s.
Daniel Williams, policing policy advocate for the ACLU of New Mexico. Thank you so much for the time.
Always a pleasure.